Hello, I'm Andrea Lipinski.
And I'm Keith DeCandido. Welcome to another very peculiar episode of The Chronic Rift.
Tonight, we're celebrating the 25th anniversary of the original Star Trek series.
It was on the 6th of September, 1966, that the NBC network first aired The Man Trap, the first broadcast episode of Star Trek, starring William Shatner as Captain Kirk, Leonard Nimoy as Mr. Spock, and about a half dozen people in the supporting cast scooting through space on the Starship Enterprise.
Frontier. These are the continuing voyages of the Starship Enterprise. Their ongoing mission to explore strange new worlds, to seek out new life forms and new civilizations, to boldly go where no man has gone.
Audience with us this evening, as well as several people who have contributed in their own way to the ever-expanding Star Trek universe. First, we have Mimi Panitch, a former editor at Pocket Books, publishers of the Trek novels.
John Ordover, who's the first line of defense against the slush pile for the Star Trek novels at Pocket Books.
And Margaret Wander Bonanno, author of such Trek novels as Strangers from the Sky and Dwellers in the Crucible, and also a novel that has absolutely nothing to do with Star Trek, Otherwhere, the sequel to The Others, which is due to be published by St. Martin's Press in November.
In the 25 years since The Man Trap was aired, Star Trek has become part of the language, part of the culture. It's one of the greatest pop culture phenomena of this century. Phrases like, he's dead, Jim, and beam me up, Scotty, and stuff like that have entered into the language and will probably stay in the language long after the original source of it has been forgotten. But when the series was first aired, it was one of NBC's worst-rated shows. What exactly did the viewers of Star Trek's original run miss in this thing that has become so big?
I'll take it if nobody else. Well, I don't think they missed anything at all. I think the audience simply hadn't been primed for science fiction yet. It there wasn't the base of science fiction fandom that there is now. They were all into books, and in fact, look down on the movies, look down on any medium other than the books, substantively. There's been a tremendous change since Star Wars. This has been a tremendous, and Star Trek, the movie, would never have been made if Star Wars hadn't been made first. They didn't miss anything at all. They just didn't exist, for the most part. There wasn't a guaranteed audience for science fiction of any type.
And I think you also have to remember that Star Trek turned out to have incredible staying power in the market. It didn't have to have a huge rating the first time out, because the people who loved it a lot and kept it alive for a long, long run. You know, there are other shows that have in their various ways become a part of popular culture. Everyone knows who the people on the Avengers were, and, you know, that wasn't a phenomenon like Miami Vice.
Also, because it transcends what people knew as science fiction at the time. You had its contemporary Lost in Space, which was robots and gadgets, as opposed to what Leonard Nimoy has always said are people stories, larger than life, operatic, if you will. But these were characters you could care about, whether they were on a spaceship or on a wagon train to the stars, which was the original metaphor for it. I think the characters were the thing that made it last.
With the this year and part of the 25th anniversary Fufura, in addition to all the other things happening, they're making another movie. Paramount put together this retrospective trailer to advertise it, and I've seen it in three different theaters, and the universal reaction has been, oh God, they're making another one? Do you think, diehard Star Trek fans are going to go see this movie because they're diehard Star Trek fans. Do you think anybody else is going to want to see this?
Oh, sure. One thing you can trace back is after the initial Zoom, everybody had to see it, Star Trek the Motion Picture, which wasn't very good movie, all told. They'll go on the reviews. Star Trek II was popular. Star Trek III, it fell off a little bit. Star Trek IV was really popular mainstream, and Star Trek V wasn't. And the reason was the reviews. Oddly enough, people are checking the reviews before they go see it, and they're checking the word of mouth. I saw Star Trek II 3 or 4 times, Star Trek IV 3 or 4 times. Saw Star Trek III once, Star Trek V one time too many. And it was because the word of my mouth was, gee, I want to go take you to this movie. It was great. I mean, Star Trek II, I lied to my friends and told them the Enterprise was destroyed in the first 2 minutes. And I wanted to take them to see the movie. Star Trek III and V, no. But Nicholas Meyer is in command of it now. And he did 2, he did 4. 6 will be good.
Yeah, I think also those of us who have been involved, you know, either professionally or as serious fans with the show, tend to forget that there's a huge audience out there that is not that involved with Star Trek, that has warm memories of the show. It's a part of their past. They know the characters. They'll go and see most of these movies, again, if the reviews are any good. But it's they're curious. The ones who are making the movies last. I think fans and professionals are much more likely to be critical than the mass audience is. You know, we have an idea of what Star Trek should be.
And
the mass audience doesn't care.
The critics always have to put that little disclaimer in the first paragraph. Oh, yeah, here they go. They're all 103 years old, and they're creeping around on the set, but they're making another movie. They don't understand why it lasts. They don't understand why, as lunatics, we'll stand online for 3 hours or 3 days in front of that theater to see these people who, at this point, are members of our family. I think we know more about them than we know about some of our relatives. And they've grown up with us. I remember standing online with a woman old enough to be my mother who said this was Wrath of Khan, and she had to know, first of all, if Spock was going to die. And I said, yes, but, you know, I'd seen it 3 times already. And she said, you know, I've grown up with these people. I started watching them when my kids were small. She said, now I'm a grandmother. I'm still watching it. I'm getting up at midnight to watch the reruns. And I found her afterwards, tears pouring down her face from the death of this mythical, you know, this fictional character, as if he was a friend of the family. So whatever it is, it's magic, but it lasts.
That's okay, I cry every time I saw Star Trek 3. Every time he died. Well, then again, on the set.
He died every time you saw it, did he?
Well, the first 25 times.
Right, the first 25 times. Then after that, I started getting numb, but...
Well, you know, Washington Stanley says, why is he bothering to straighten his uniform? I mean, come on.
Oh, that's Spock.
It's Spock.
Well, yeah.
Stop.
Anyway.
But maybe not as many people will be willing to see it now after Star Trek V.
Oh, no, the audience bounced back after 3, which wasn't, 3 was also not very well reviewed.
What?
Go on, no, that was my question.
Oh, okay. The rumor, the scuttlebutt has it that this is going to be the last movie. Where do you think will happen now after this, because there won't be a new source for, a new official source for Star Trek, for Kirk, Spock, and McCoy at least?
Well, it's going to be interesting. Perhaps the books will subsume the, perhaps the books will subsume the role of it. Perhaps the DC comic book will. DC comic book was carrying the ball for a while there between Star Trek 2 and 3. It was doing this pathway between 2 and 3 that was very nice. Probably the books, I don't know. Kirk, Spock, and McCoy will probably start showing up on The Next Generation.
Yeah, well.
In one way or another, in cryogenic suspension, in weird old tapes that are suddenly discovered of a mystery that Kirk in the past solved or something.
Do you think there should be some sort of control on it, on as to what happens? I mean, obviously there's control on the TV series because it's all involved in the same studio, but there's a lot more room for chaos in the novels. If this is going to be the official thing.
Well, yeah, I actually have strong feelings about that.
Oh, okay.
One of the things about the novels and about the substantial body of unpublished fiction is that really there's a tremendous acceptance out there of multiple timelines. There's no reason that there has to be one canonical, this is what happened timeline. You can do alternate versions of what happened to these people. You can do alternate versions of, say, Vulcan society. People have done it. You know, there's no particular theoretical reason I can see why, once you've broken loose from the rigidity of the television format, you can't just let people play with this mythos the same way that writers have played over the years with the King Arthur stories. You know, you can have different versions, and I think it's very short-sighted of Paramount and of the people currently in control of the various publishing programs not to embrace that. And the audience has been very receptive to real creativity being introduced.
Also, if they're not going to allow for that, something should be written down someplace as opposed to, well, that was okay last Tuesday, but it's not okay this Tuesday. There is no Bible, as there is for the TV series. It's simply, well, yes, we said you could do that when you started to write the manuscript, but we've changed our minds. No reasons are given. And so you get into conflicts depending on who's in charge, and that changes with an ever-increasing rapidity. So the result is chaos. Any sense of trying to control where the characters are going. And once the characters are freed of the actors, which is not to put the actors down, but let's face it, they're getting older, you have characters who in their own century can certainly live well past 100. If you free them from the bodies of these aging actors, there's no place you can't take the characters in the alternate formats, in the novels, in the comics, where you don't have to worry about, well, that's going to blow our special effects budget, we can't do it. Unfortunately, there's too much short-sightedness among the people in charge now. They can't see that, and so they're holding it down, and I think they're choking it at this point.
Just to take the opposite point of view, I mostly agree with the try it in alternate formats approach, but part of what the fans are going for is soap opera. They want the next installment of the soap opera of Kirk, Spock, McCoy, even though nothing has changed, really, ever. They want the next episode, and if you're going to be giving them the next episode, it has to be in the same Days of Our Lives. Can't suddenly decide, okay, we're going to do the alternate story of Luke and Laura or whatever.
Yeah.
You need
Dallas
the next
Dallas.
Issue.
I agree, but
yeah,
you can do both at once.
Yes,
Dark Shadows is the classic example. You know, they started running alternate plot lines involving more or less the same people in different costumes, and people ate it up. And you see that in the fan fiction. At some point, you know, I've forgotten the details, somebody was running a timeline based on the Mirror Mirror universe. And there's no reason, again,
you could even put different color covers on them so that people could really literally choose their flavor.
Fine, Star Trek Classic, Star Trek The Next Generation, and Star Trek somewhere in the middle, yeah.
Why not?
But the core audience would certainly absorb more than one storyline going at once.
I think it's a little short-sighted of them not to be willing, for instance, to consider novels with completely different characters set in the Star Trek universe.
Yeah.
Simply on a matter of bottom line, sleazy merchandising marketing, we can expand our market. Every
and
one of our Star Trek
also
episodes is a bestseller on a play off it.
The minor characters, Uhura, Sulu, Chekhov, what happens to these people? They have lives. Lord knows in the syndication, their lines always get cut. Some of Sulu's best lines in the movies are ad-libs. They're not in the script. So why can't we explore them in the novels and the comics? The official word is no. Kirk has to be the center of this thing. There's no variation. And yet, we who get the fan letters saying, oh, I'm so sick of Kirk, would you please do something else? Or, we liked your original characters, which is a big taboo lately. Original characters are supposed to be flat, two-dimensional cardboard and get killed off by chapter 3.
Preferably wearing red shirts.
Yes.
The idea is to raise lower prose to the level of television.
Yeah. Oh. The universe is shrinking rather than expanding.
Yeah, which is sort of silly in a format that's set up, first of all, it's supposed to be a huge military organization, and yet we keep coming back to the same ship that does
not
everything.
Not military. They're not military.
Well,
not
they're
this
paramilitary.
But it's still, it's a large organization.
Yeah.
Full of all these dozens of ships, and the only time we see another ship, it's usually an incompetent for Kirk to knock down.
And there are also a lot of civilians in this universe, too.
Right.
What about
no, they're
that?
Not. No. I've never seen them.
I've heard rumors.
Nope, it's these eight guys and a few planets.
Right.
And that's pretty much it.
And a bunch of extras walking around the hall.
Right, in red shirts to be shut off. Yes. Rosencrantz and Guildenstern are on the Enterprise and they're wearing red shirts.
Right.
There it is.
John, do you happen to know what the current circulation figures are, just for a standard?
Oh, 2 million. 2 million for something. It averages around there. Some of them, known authors, actually, like Peter David, actually do better. But it's like the difference between 3 and 7 on the New York Times bestseller list. It's really astounding. And I heard someone in the office explaining to someone else at one point that, no, we're not supposed to just say that these are always going to be bestsellers. We have to make it seem like it's our doing that makes them bestsellers. But it's really, the Star Trek thing is just phenomenal.
Okay, what we're going to be doing now is our memorable moment, and then we will be taking some more questions from the audience, so we're not going to shut you guys up altogether. You're going to get to talk more. What you get to do is have a break and have a drink. We have a memorable moment from Mr. Albert II. Dear Andrea and Keith, this was a tough one, a memorable moment from Star Trek. There are too many to count. How about the final scene from part one of The Menagerie? Here we see Spock's loyalties divided between Kirk and Pike. Besides, it's a better cliffhanger than this year's Next Generation.
Barb.
And okay, for you.
We've got the goodies. Goodie number one is Bruce Ferguson's The Mace of Souls, which is a fantasy book. The next thing we've got is Surfing Samurai Robots.
A sexist book.
By Bill Hilton. He was the first alien to invade Earth. And because this is the Star Trek memorable moment, we have a Star Trek book donated by Pocket Books, Prime Directive, by Garfield and Judith Reeve Stevens, currently one of the latest best-selling thingy whoosie whats it's from Pocket Books. And here's the memorable moment.
Further contact. Message signed. Comsol Starfleet Command.
Mr. Spock, you're aware of the orders regarding any contact with Talos IV. You have deliberately invited the death penalty. You've not only finished yourself, Spock, but you finished your captain as well.
Commodore must be aware that Captain Kirk knew nothing of this.
And you're aware that a captain is responsible for everything that occurs on his ship. I order you to return this vessel back to manual control.
Sir, I respectfully decline.
Very well, you've earned the consequences. This court is in recess.
You're doing? Have you lost your mind?
Captain. Jim, please. Don't stop me. Don't let him stop me. It's your career and Captain Pike's life. You must see the rest of the transmission. Lock him up.
To embarrass these three individuals with questions. First up,
please say your name into the mic and then ask the question.
My name is Mike Ficarra. My question is for Margaret. As an author of Star Trek novels, do you find yourself cautious on using the buzzwords and the cliches from Star Trek, like beam me up, Scotty, or damn it, Jim, I'm a doctor, not a farmer, or whatever?
Sometimes you can't resist, you know. If you can work them into the context without their going clunk, yeah, by all means. I also love to refer to previous episodes and weave them all together and steal characters that other people have created and work them into my novels. Riley is a favorite of mine. Whatever helps, you know, because what we're trying to do is weave this all together, the books, the episodes, the movies, as one big picture. Despite the people who try to thwart us, that's what we're trying to do. And if you can use a line or, you know, take somebody else's line and give it to a different character so that the reader's going, huh? By all means, whatever helps.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, next. We have another one.
My name is Dan Persons, and I have a question for the panel. One of the things I've heard is that as far as a marketing phenomenon is concerned, Star Trek is sort of an anomaly in that movie studios are trying to go for the international market, European and Japanese particularly. Whereas Star Trek is more popular in America than it is anywhere else.
Well, that's not exactly accurate. It has a really substantive foreign market. It's very American in attitude. It really is. I mean, it has an American kind of feel to it, but it translates quite well. It doesn't translate as well as an Arnold Schwarzenegger action movie in which the dialogue ends 5 minutes into the movie and picks up at the end when he says, I'll be back, or see you next movie, or I'm going to be the good guy again next movie or something. It's certainly a worldwide phenomenon.
The other question I have, just one more, is if the Enterprise is such a computer-controlled ship, what are all those guys doing up on the bridge in between planets?
Oh, well, I can respond to that very easily, which is, you may have noticed that there's a certain technophobia going on in both, especially in the old Star Trek, also in the new Star Trek. They don't like to be mechanized, they don't like to be machine-controlled. I mean, that was the whole point of the episode, The Ultimate Computer. They believe in supervising their computers closely, and so they have guys there watching what the computers are going to do. As you would, I mean, an aircraft carrier is violently, highly computerized nowadays, but it's a guy watching each computer panel.
You also don't want to put all those actors out of work.
Yes. Computers can't fall out of their chairs when they're hit by a phaser.
Right, that's true.
Thank you.
Technically, neither can people.
Hey, I know you.
You should. Voice of the Rift, Orenthal Hawkins, has a question.
I wanted to know what your first experiences with Star Trek were. I find it curious to see where people learned about Star Trek and what made them such big fans of the show.
Let's go left to right. Then we can start.
I'm going to be a disappointment. I got into all of this by accident. You know, it was on when I was a kid. I watched it. I liked it. I wasn't an addict. When I started looking for a job in publishing, you know, I had read a lot of science fiction, and I chose a science fiction editorial job. We happened to get the Star Trek tie-ins in while I was there, and I found myself, you know, unlike all of the people who were saying, oh God, a tie-in project, you're going to die, it's going to be awful, actually reading fan submissions and thinking, well, you know, there are people who are writing good Star Trek out there. This job could be fun. You could make something of this job.
I think I probably found Star Trek at the time when a lot of other people find religion. And sort of got into it probably when I was about 14 really heavily. That's when I was conventionizing everything. Tell you what got me out of Star Trek fandom was the first movie, which was, whatever anyone else may say, it is abysmal. And when they went around in their little sort of, it was wonderful. It was better than Cats. I'm going to see it again and again kind of thing. I said, you guys are nuts! And I just sort of left it until Star Trek II and then got back. And, it's a hook. The characters are fun and they're smart, which isn't very... So they think their way out of things. They don't shoot their way out of things except in a smart way. I mean, Kirk doesn't just say, well, bring out the really big gun now. It's quick. Corbomite maneuver, quick, accelerate, stop, go back, pretend to be a sensor ghost. Right? It was intelligent, and that's what attracted me.
Margaret?
I can sum it up in one word, Spock. I was 16, I couldn't get a date, and there he was
and
on my TV
Spock.
Screen, and he took me seriously. There's even an episode, it's an awful episode, in which Kirk is going on about how beautiful a woman is, and Spock is like, Captain, beauty is, after all, transitory. However, she seemed quite intelligent.
Yeah.
How many... real adult men, do you know, who will say something like that about a woman? He can be all things to all people. And for his sake, I tolerate Kirk and his nonsense.
My next question is, in episode 31...
Move out of your parents' basement and grow the hell up!
Oh, boy. People are slow. Okay, that's all we've got time for. We're wrapping it up. Yes, we must stop.
Okay.
This has been fun, though. We even had the studio audience, which could have asked a few more questions, but didn't. That's good. Okay. So, what are we doing next week? Tell everybody what we're doing next week.
Next week, we're doing Attack of the Killer Bee Movies.
Bee movies?
Yeah, this is right up there with the artichoke that ate Arkansas and the prune that sat on Texas. And let's see.
We're going to talk about these things.
Well, yeah, we're gonna sit there and go, hey, did you ever see the one where, I don't know, the one where the Danish came over and ate Wisconsin or something like that?
Or something like that.
Right.
Well, I hope you'll be there. We'll certainly will. Back to the old format. We'll see you next week. Good night.
This episode was sponsored in part by Comics Interview, the magazine where both the fans and the pros turn to see who's who and how it's done. Me, Comics Interview number 100. And see who the 100 most powerful people in the comics industry are. For a free catalog, write to Comics Interview, 234 Fifth Avenue, Suite 301, New York, New York, 10001. You like Star Trek? You'll love the adventures of Miles Rokossian by Loris McMaster Bujold. Everything you always wanted in a science fiction adventure. Catch Barrier, coming in October 1991. Loris McMaster Bujold and Miles Rokossian, only from Bain Books. Starfleet's most sacred commandment has been violated. Its most honored captain is in disgrace. Its most celebrated starship in pieces. And the crew of that ship scattered among the thousand worlds of the Federation. Now, based on the events that took place in the final year of the Enterprise's original five-year mission, comes Prime Directive, an all-new Star Trek novel, just released in paperback from Pocket Books.